So good morning one and all. So in the last class we started with the uniform quantizer. So what is uniform quantizer? So it quantizes the sampled signals. And what is the quantization means? Rounding up the sampled value to the nearest quantization level. So why it is called uniform? Because here the step size, that is delta, remains same. Okay, so yeah, so the step size of the uniform quantizer is simply 2x maximum by L, where L is the number of quantization levels. So that will be equal to 2 power N. So what is N? The number of encoding bits. So obviously we are discussing with ADC, analog digital converter. What are the three important blocks of ADC? Sampling, quantization and encoding. Okay, so combinedly these three are called ADC. Now, so we are using n-bit encoding. So if, for example, if you take n equal to 2, we get 4 code words. What are they? 00, 01, 10, 11. So we are quantizing using a uniform quantizer, and delta we are getting. So there will be a quantization error, that is sampled value minus quantized value. Yeah, so the quantization is an irreversible process. Okay, now I have taken an example to illustrate the concept of quantization. Here what happened? This is an analog signal, continuous time signal. It is sampled. I have taken the samples. The sample values I have taken like 1.38, minus 0.2, minus 1.6. And this is a quantizer. This is a 2-bit quantizer because it has got 4 levels. So delta equal to 1 from the formula. X maximum is 2, minimum is minus 2. And have divided into intervals, 4 intervals. These are the interval limits. Here I have carefully written the limits, because here the first interval is from minus 2 excluding, including, minus 1 excluding. In the second interval, minus 1 is included, 0 is excluded, so on so on. Now what is the quantization level? It's a midpoint of the interval. Okay, suppose 1, you take a sample signal 1, sampled is 1. It lies in the third interval, it is quantized to 0.5 and it is encoded as 10, which means this sample, first sample, that is value is, let us take 1 for example, the first sample is quantized as 0.5 and encoded as 10, which means, so for one sample we have 2 bits. For the first sample, what is the corresponding bit or code word? 10. For each sample there is a code word which contains 2 bits. Like this, this is a table which gives you sampled values, quantized values and error and the corresponding code words or bits. Now this is the digital signal for the analog signal. For this signal, this is the transformation to digital. Okay, now so the minimum error is minus delta by 2, the maximum is delta by 2. It always lies between minus delta by 2 to plus delta by 2. Now, so here I told you one thing, that so this quantization is a irreversible process. Okay, why? So if you observe very carefully, I have taken okay, so let us take, suppose this is the analog signal, which is a cos, a sine waveform from 0 to, let us take 4 seconds. So its maximum amplitude is plus 2, minimum is minus 2. Suppose if we sample this, we get x of n. Okay, so these are samples. Okay, I have taken so many samples. So but all these sample values will lie between plus 2 to minus 2. You take any sample, its values lie between plus 2 to minus 2. Why? Because the signal itself is varying from plus 2 to minus 2. Obviously, its samples also varies from plus 2 to minus 2. Okay, so you take any number of samples, but suppose we are quantizing. Okay, you take all these samples, give it to the quantizer. The quantizer output is having only 4 possibilities. Okay, no matter what number of samples you take, all will be quantized to any one of these four levels. Okay, to input to the quantizer you can give infinite number of samples, but all will be quantized to or mapped to only four discrete levels. Okay, so here we have a money to few mapping. It is not unique mapping. Okay, why? Because suppose if you take a sample value 2, what happens? It lies in the fourth interval, it is quantized to 1.5. 2 is quantized to 1.5. Okay, suppose if I take one more sample, let us take here, whose value is 1.8. It is different sample, 1.8. It also lies in the fourth interval, so 1.8 also quantized to 1.5. Obviously, two different signal quantized to the same value. It is not a unique mapping. It is a many to few mapping. So you might have seen one to one mapping, all those things. So since it is not a one to one mapping, it is a not reversible. It is an irreversible process. Okay? Why? Because suppose if the output is 1.5, you cannot say input is either 2 or 1.8, or it could be any other value between what? 1 and 2. Okay, you take any value between 1 and 2, between 1 and 2 we may get infinity values, infinity sampled values, all will be quantized to only 1.5. Obviously, so reverse is not possible. If output is 1.5, you cannot say what is input, because we have so many possibilities for inputs. Okay, it is a reversible process. But whereas sampling is a reversible process, why? Because I explained how to sample, how to reconstruct. But so this is quantization is irreversible, which means once you are done with the quantization, you cannot reverse it. Okay, so that's why there is a quantization error. It will be there always, you cannot remove that. Okay, but you can only minimize it. Okay, so we are discussing uniform quantizer. It is two types, mid-rise, mid-rate. Okay, so this is the input output of the quantizer, uniform quantizer. It is a staircase like structure. It is symmetric about origin, and so this is about the, it is a 2-bit or 4-level uniform quantizer. 4-level, what type of quantizer? Mid-rise. Why? Because origin lies in the middle of the rising part of the quantizer. Okay, so here we have an even number of levels. L will be 2 power n here. Obviously we get even number. So one is mid-rate quantizer, where the origin lies in the middle of the third of the staircase. Here we get odd number of levels. You might be wonder how L will be odd number. Generally here L will be, we take 2 power n minus 1. Okay, it is one type of uniform quantizer. L will be 2 power n minus 1. But so we don't use this quantizer very frequently. Okay, so you forget this, but you remember L equal 2 power n only. Okay, so if they mention the uniform quantizer, by default it is a mid-rise quantizer. If they mention specifically we are using mid-rate uniform quantizer, where you have to go with L equal 2 power n minus 1, L should be odd here. Okay, but mostly we go with the mid-rise uniform quantizer, where L will be equal 2 power n. You stick to this. But if they mention specifically it is a mid-rate uniform quantizer, you have to go with this. But it is very rare to occur. Okay, so let us remember L equal 2 power n, right? Obviously, so because of quantization, we get error that is called quantization error, which is between less or minus delta by 2. It can be 0 also, but minimum is minus delta by 2, the maximum is delta by 2. Obviously, if delta is more, Q also more. If delta is more, Q also more. Okay. Now, this graph gives you the quantization error. This is Q. Q lies between plus or minus delta by 2. This is plus or minus delta by 2. It varies between plus or minus delta by 2. Okay. Actually, this graph, so this is the uniform quantizer. But this straight line is without quantization. If don't quantize, sampled values won't change. Now, what is error? Error is the difference between quantized value and sampled value. Now what is error? This is error. This region is error. So this region represents error. Okay, this region. Okay, here this region. Let me write here the black color. Okay, so this is the region which represents the error. Okay, this region here, this gap. This gap. So if you draw properly, it would look like this, just like a sawtooth waveform. Okay. So that is about quantization error. Yeah. So this is the difference between mid-rise, mid-rate, uniform. Both are uniform quantizers only. Uniform means they have same step size, uniform step size. Yes. Okay. So for uniform quantization, the error Q is between less or minus delta by 2 and it is uniformly distributed. We assume that Q is random in nature. You can see here, it is randomly varying between less or minus delta by 2. So we model it as a random variable. What random variable? Uniformly distributed random variable. You know already what do you mean by uniform distributed random variable. This is X, this is fx of x. This is a probability density function of a uniformly distributed random variable. Here I am writing different notation, but it is okay. Fq of q. Q is for what? Quantization noise. Okay. So if something is random, we get noise from it. Q is error. Capital Q is a random noise. Or it is a random noise because of this random. First of all, it is a uniformly distributed random variable. Uniform random variable. From this uniform random variable, we get a random noise. Okay. Anyway, I am writing fx of x only. So for our convenience purpose. Okay. So what is the mean of this? What expectation of x? Find out. How much you get? What the formula? Integration x into fx of x. Okay, so this is x. X varies from where to where? Less or minus delta by 2. You find out, you get 0. You get this as 0. Mean is 0. Okay, what about second moment? Expectation of x square. What the formula? Integration x square into fx of x. Okay, first of all, what is fx of x? Actually 1 by delta. Why? Because it is minus delta by 2 plus delta by 2. If you remember properly, what we have done? We have done from a to b. What is this? 1 by b minus a. Obviously, both are equal and opposite. It is 1 by delta by 2 minus or minus delta by 2. It is 1 by delta. Please remember, fx of x is 1 by delta from minus delta by 2 plus delta by 2. Okay. So what about this? What do you get now? It is from minus delta by 2 plus delta by 2 x square into 1 by delta dx. You have to write dx. So what happens now? 1 by delta anyway constant, outside integration, x cube by 3. So minus delta by 2 delta by 2. What is this? Okay, so delta cube by 8, what do you get? 1 by delta, 1 by 3 delta, this is delta cube by 8 plus again delta cube by 8. What happens now? 2 delta cube by 8 into 1 by 3 delta. Delta delta cancels. It is delta square by 12. Okay, so please go through this calculation later, which means, so the expectation of x square, the second moment or mean square value is delta square by 12. Now what is the variance? Okay, so actually we should write it is q only, no problem. I am writing instead of x, I am writing q. Okay, okay, right. What is variance? Expectation of x square, that is delta square by 12 minus mean square. What is the mean? 0. Obviously the variance of the quantization noise is equal to delta square by 12. So variance is nothing but power. So quantization noise power is denoted with, so please here let us go to the our notations, that is sigma q square is equal to delta square by 12. Okay, so here I use notation x for our convenience, but you must write this is q. You have mentioned very clearly, right? Yeah, q. Q is actually the uniform random variable, uniform distributed random variable, which represents quantization noise power, quantization noise. Okay, so now, so same thing we have done here. Yes, so if take logarithm on both sides, what are you getting? So okay, one more thing you can do here is what is delta? That is step size of the uniform quantizer. It is given as 2x maximum by L. What is L? 2 power n. By default L is 2 power n. X maximum by 2 power n. So what about delta square by 12? Delta square means sigma q square is equal to 4x maximum square by 12 L square. Okay. Now this will be equal to 1 by 3. X maximum square by L square. But what is L? 2 power n. You can further write this as 2 power n means 4 power n, because 4 power n. So what do you get finally? Here is 1 by 3 X maximum square by L square. So after that you can write L equal 2 power n. So 2 power 2n or 4n. Yeah, so let me write it is 1 by 3 x maximum square by 2 power 2n or 4 power n. So this is what the quantization noise power of a uniform quantizer. Okay, so you can write this in the logarithm in dBs. You take 10 log on both sides, sigma square of q in dBs. dBs means take 10 log on both sides. What do you get is minus 4.77 plus 20 log x maximum minus 6.0 to n. Okay, you go through it once. Just taking logarithm on both sides is the, you get the quantization noise power in dBs. How much is this? Minus 4.77 plus 6.0 to n plus what is there? Minus, okay, I'm sorry, this is also minus. Anyway, it's not required, but you should have a habit of writing in dBs also. Plus 20 log sigma xy, what is that? Okay, 20 log x maximum. Sorry, 20 log x maximum base 10. So let me check one more time if it is correct or not. Yeah, so that is in dBs. Anyway, okay. So one more important aspect of this quantization is we have to find out SQNR. SQNR. Suppose you know SNR. What is that? Signal power by noise power. In the similar way, here you find out SQNR. What does it mean? Signal power by quantization noise power. Because here we are dealing with the quantization noise, not the channel noise. That is different. Now we are dealing with the quantization noise power. It is called as SQNR. It is just like SNR. What is that? Signal power by the quantization noise power. Sometimes in some textbook they call this as SNR itself. You don't get confused. SNR of quantizer they call. Otherwise, they can call SQNR, which is defined as signal power to the quantization noise power ratio. Obviously, so this we know already. Just now we calculated how much you got, delta square by 12. Please remember this is very, very important. So later we have substituted delta equal to 2x maximum by L. So you got some other form, but this is a basic idea. So signal power by quantization noise power, that is called as SQNR. Okay, so let us assume that signal power is sigma x square, and assume that that is also a random signal. Signal power. So x of t is a signal, analog signal, whose power is sigma x square. So what is the quantization noise power? We are calling it the sigma q square. These are two powers, signal power and the quantization noise power. Obviously, SQNR is the ratio of two powers, that is sigma x square by sigma q square. Obviously, sigma q square is already calculated. So what you get here is sigma x square by delta square by 12. So if you take 12 into the numerator, it would become 12 into sigma x square by delta square. So this is the SQNR formula. This is a basic formula. Later you can substitute what is delta, and here we don't know what is the signal power. This is unknown to us. Okay, depends upon type of signal, first of all. So if substitute L equal 2 power n and all those things, what happens here now? Okay, so finally how much you are getting? If substitute delta equal to 2x maximum by L, it is 3 into 2 power 2n by sigma x by x maximum whole square. Okay, so it is 3 into 2 power 2n into sigma x by x maximum whole square. This is the final SQNR formula. Okay. Otherwise, what is 2 power 2n? Actually, that is L square. 3 into L square into sigma x by x maximum whole square. What is x maximum? That is a quantizer limit. What is sigma x square? Please remember, sigma x square is the variance of the x of t. Variance represents power. So sigma x square is the signal power. If I write sigma x, it is become standard deviation of the signal. You know already. If you take the under root of the variance, it gives you standard deviation. Anyway, so please remember, this is not sigma square. Here we have sigma x by x maximum whole square. Okay. So this is, here also you can write this in the logarithms. dBs, because always represents power in dBs. So SQNR in dBs. To get in dBs, take 10 log base 10 on both sides. So 10 log 3, how to do this? 10 log 3 base 10 plus 2 power n log 2 base 10 plus 20 log sigma x by x maximum base 10. Are you getting what I'm saying? Yeah. 10 log, so you take logarithm to this quantity. You know already how to take logarithms. 3 is multiplied with 2 power 2n. Obviously, in logarithm it becomes plus. 10 log 3 base 10 plus 20n log 2 base 10. Yeah, so because 2n comes this side, okay, plus 20n log base 10 sigma x by x maximum. So if substitute 10 log 3, that is 4.77. plus 20 into log 2 base 10, that is 6.02n, plus 20n log base 10 sigma x by x maximum. So let me write here, this is very, very important. So in dBs it is 4.77 plus 6.02n plus 20 log sigma x by x maximum. So this is the SQNR in dBs. Always try try to remember everything in dBs also. Okay. So what is observation? 4.77 is a constant. 6.02 into n. What is n? It is a encoding capacity. Okay. So plus 20 log sigma x by x maximum. Okay. So it depends upon n. What is n? Depends on n value. If n equal to 1, what happens? It is 4.77 plus 6.02 plus this. If n equal to 2, it is 4.7 plus 6.02 into 2, that is 12.04. So what exactly happens here is, so for n equal to 1, n equal to 2, observe these two last two equations. How much is the difference between them? The difference is around 6 dB. Okay. So if increase n value by 1, SQNR increases approximately by 6 dB. If n equal to 1 and if n equal to, the difference is 6 dB. So if increase the n value by 1, SQNR increases by 6 dB. So this is for n equal to 1. It is for n equal to 2. The gap is approximately 6 dB. Okay. So here we have drawn the graph between what? SQNR, this is equal to XQNR, no? SQNR versus this quantity. Please be careful. I have drawn the graph between SQNR versus, this is y axis, what x axis? 20 log sigma x by x maximum. Where is that? This quantity. Okay. Now, so it is, you get a linear curve. Why linear? Because it is around 4.77 plus 6n. Okay. Obviously, if n equal to 1, you get some value. If n equal to, you get some other value. The difference is around 6 dB. So if you increase the n value by 1, you get 6 dB increment in the SQNR of a uniform quantizer. That is a simple logic. Now, okay, so till now I did not mention the type of input signal. I just told you we are having any type of input signal. Suppose if you take a sinusoidal input, what will happen? Okay, suppose if you take x of t equal to am cos 2 pi fmt, obviously, so the maximum value of the signal is am, sigma x square is power of that signal, that is am square by 2. What is delta? I hope you can calculate this. So delta equal to 2x maximum by L. So that is 2am by L. Delta square equal to all those things. So delta square by 2L equal to am square by 3L square. Okay. So you don't get confused by these calculations. Just what I'm saying is x of t equal to am cos omega mt. Some cos signal, sinusoidal input. What is sigma x square? Obviously, the power of the signal is am square by 2. So generally, the quantizer limit should be exactly same as the input signal limits. We should maintain that. Okay. So what is x maximum should be? Maximum value of input signal, that is am. Always we should maintain the quantizer limit should be exactly same as the maximum amplitude of the input signal. But it is not necessarily be the input signal amplitude. So what I'm saying is here. So here, suppose the quantizer limits are only from 2 to 3. Okay, let me explain this because we are getting confused. Here, I have written overload here. Okay, so our quantizer operates from plus 2 to minus 2 only. Okay. So your input signal should be in that range only. Suppose if you input more than 2, what will happen? It will be clipped off. What will happen here is, suppose you are giving the quantizer operating from plus 2 to minus 2, but your input is from 3 to minus 3. What will happen? It is overloading the quantizer. Then what the quantizer will do? It will clip off the extra portion. This will be clipped up. This portion will be clipped up. it will only quantize what portion? This portion. Here to here, here to here, here to here, here to here, here to here. So this is overloaded. It will be clipped off. Okay. Right. So okay. So without wasting much time. Yeah. So x maximum is am. Then what will happen? Okay, you calculate from here onwards. Okay, what is delta? 2x maximum L, 2am by L. That is delta. What is delta square by 12? That is the quantization noise power. 4am square by L square. Sorry, 12L square, right? 4am square by 12L square, which means am square by 3L square. That is sigma q square. This is sigma q square. So this is sigma x square, am square by 12. Okay, so help me. What is SKNR? In normal scale, am square by 2 by am square by 3L square. Obviously, this is 3 by 2L square, if I'm not wrong. Obviously, you can also write 3 by 2. What is L? 2 power n. That is 4 power n. Okay. Yes. Yeah. So you can take this in this also as a logarithm scale. Then what would you get? So what would you get? So it is 10 log. What is 3.3 by 2? 1.5 base 10 plus obviously 10 n log 4 base 10. Okay. So what would happen? So it is approximately equal to, this is 1.8 plus 6n in dBs. So this is SQNR in dBs for what type of input signal? Sinusoidal input signal. For normal signals, I mean for general signal, what is the formula of SQNR? This is a signal. Okay, 4.77 plus 6.02n plus 20 log sigma x by x maximum. Okay, in this expression you can substitute sigma x maximum. Okay, what x maximum? Am. What is sigma x? Sigma x square is am square by 12. Sigma x is always am by root 2. Okay, substitute here also you get same value. So you may, I think you got a difference between these two. Here also, SQNR increased by 6 dB if you increase the n value by 1. That is about uniform quantizer. Okay. So, now, so let us go for non-uniform quantizer. Okay. So, obviously, non-uniform quantizer, the name itself indicates the step size is not uniform. Why it was uniform quantizer earlier? Because the step size was same everywhere. Okay. Now, so let us go with the non-uniform quantizer. Now, what is the problem with uniform quantizers? The problem with uniform quantizer is, actually, you have drawn the graph, no? How was the graph? Actually, it was a graph between SQNR versus input power. So, this graph is from for SQNR versus this input power actually. Input power only. More or less it is power. It's a relative power. Okay. How it is? It is linear, almost linear. Okay. So if it is this, what is the problem? What is the problem? So if the input's power is low, SQNR is low. If the input power is more, SQNR is more. Okay. Obviously, we want to have more SQNR. Just like SNR, we want to have more SNR. But what is happening here? For low input signals, low SQNR. For high power signals, high SQNR. We have a problem with this itself. So we call weak signal, strong signal. For weak signal, low SQNR. for a strong signal, high SPNR. Okay. Is it good or bad? It is not always good. Why? So, here, let us discuss when it is not valid. Okay. Money speech signals has non-uniform distribution. Okay. So, the distribution of speech signal is non-uniform. What do you mean by this? Okay. Because if you take the speech power distribution of the speech signal, it is very dynamic, very non-uniform. Because so the intensity of the speech varies from person to person. Each person speaks with different intensities. Not only that, the same person speaks with different intensity at different times. We won't speak with the same amount of intensity all the time. Okay, our voice intensity will vary with time and will vary with person to person. Okay, but you got my point. Our speech intensity varies from time to time. Okay, suppose if I am speaking like this, I won't be speaking with the same intensity all the time. In the same time, it varies from person to person. So my voice intensity is different, yours is different. Okay. Now it is very non-uniform distribution kind of thing. So, but not only that, it is found that smaller amplitudes predominate in the speech and larger amplitudes are much less frequent. What do you mean by this? In the speech signal, the smaller amplitudes, let us take, they are very much predominant, occurs very frequently. So, larger amplitudes occurs very rarely. That is its observation. So, generally, we speak normally. Okay. Sometimes we speak loudly. Okay. So, that is simple observation, right? Most common thing is the speech signal is having very low amplitudes. But sometimes your speech signal will have some larger amplitudes. Okay. But weak speech is more predominant compared to the strong speech. Okay. What I want to say is weak speech is more predominant or occurs more frequently. Okay. Compared to the strong speech. I hope you got my point. Okay. Right. Now. But what is happening? Because of uniform quantization, so whether you speak, we have a weak or strong, what is happening? Weak means low SPNR, strong means high SPNR. That is not at all acceptable to us. Okay. The irony is like this. Weak speech occurs very frequently, but it has got low SPNR. Okay. And so strong speech occur very rarely, it has got high SPNR. Okay. So we have to protect the weak speech, which occurs more frequently compared to the strong speech. Okay. Now, yeah, for that we go for non-uniform quantization. Obviously, in non-uniform quantization, the step size are not at all uniform. They will be varying. How they vary? They vary like this. So, this is input, output. Now, this is the non-uniform quantization characterization. You can observe very carefully. Here, the step size is this. Here, the step size is this. Here, what is step size? This. The step size is not same. It is varying. So, it is a simply called non-uniform quantizer. The step size varies. But how it varies? That is the question. It is varying. That is okay. But how it is varying? Okay. So, you can observe. As you move away from the origin, the step size is increasing. You can see very clearly. as you move away from the origin, the step size is increasing. Okay, why? Why it should be like that? The question is why it should be like that. So the basic idea is like this. Okay, the basic idea is what is happening here is, so for low input amplitudes, low step size. Okay, what happened here is this input signal, no input value. If input value is low, 0 to 2, let us take, the step size is low. If input amplitude is little bit more, 2 to 4, we are increasing step size. If the amplitude is even more, 4 to 6, we are increasing the step size. Okay, so the step size increases according to the input amplitude. Okay, so for low signals or for weak signal, low delta. This is delta, no? Actually, what is step size? Delta. For weak signal means signal with low amplitude. Here, weak signal, step size is low. For strong signal, more step size here. If the signal is strong, it is having more amplitude, 6 to 8, we have more step size. 2 to 4, it is having very little amplitude or weak signal, we have a very little step size. Okay, now step size varies according to the intensity of this speech or signal. For weak speech, weak delta. For strong speech, strong delta. Okay, so we are varying in this fashion. Okay, now, so why are we doing so? What is the objective of doing so? This is the 3-bit non-uniform quantizer. Okay, 3-bit means you get 8 levels, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, but all are having different deltas, so it is non-uniform. Now here you can clearly observe the difference between uniform and non-uniform quantization. For non-uniform quantization, what is happening here? So this is the strong signal. Okay, we have a strong step size or large step size. Okay, here this is a weak signal because its amplitude is low. What is step size? Low. Okay, so for large signal, large step size. For small signal, small step size. That is the concept of non-uniform quantization. But so in the uniform quantization, whether it is a weak or strong signal, doesn't matter, we always maintain a uniform step size. This is a uniform step size. Here, sorry, this is a uniform step size. You observe these things very clearly in your PPT. Okay, now, so what is the idea behind this? The idea is, it is called principle of progressive taxation. Let me explain this little bit. What happened here is, it is a principle of progressive taxation. Progressive taxation. What do you mean by this? Okay, here, so you know already, we pay income tax. The government collects income tax from the citizens of the country. Okay, how the income tax will be collected? It is not uniform for all citizens. Okay, so if you know this income tax things, for poor people, the tax will be low. Obviously, for rich people, tax will be more. okay, which means if you earn more money, you have to pay more tax. If you earn less money, you have to pay less tax. The income tax is not uniform. Okay, so if you know all these things, suppose if your income is below 5 lakhs per annum, you don't have to pay any tax. If it is more than 5 lakhs, you have to pay a little bit of tax. If it is more than 10 lakhs, you have to pay more tax. More money, more tax. Okay, now it is called progressive taxation. Okay, so if you earn more money, you have to pay more tax. If you earn less money, you have to pay less tax. So we are following this method. Why? The reason is to reduce the gap between rich and poor. So to reduce the economic gap between the citizens, we are doing this method. We are following this method. Okay, so the tax will be not same for all. Suppose if you earn 10 lakhs, you have to pay this much amount of money. If you earn 1 crore per annum, you have to pay more tax. More in the name means tax rate, I'm talking about rate of the tax. Okay, so we are doing so to overcome to bridge the gap between the rich and poor. Okay, what exactly we are doing? You know what exactly we are doing? We are punishing the rich people by taking more tax, and we are compensating that for poor people. Okay, so we are doing so that there won't be economic gaps. Okay, same thing, you take same analogy. What is happening? Weak signal, strong signal. What are you doing? We are having less step size for weak signal, more step size for strong signal, so that they behave same. Otherwise, they have a same SQNR. Whether signal is weak or strong, doesn't matter. We should have a constant SQNR. Okay? So whether you are poor or not, poor or rich, so you should have a same amount of money. You have to pay the same amount of money, or you have to reduce the gap between rich and poor. Okay, so we are punishing the rich and compensating the poor. In the same way, we are punishing the strong signal and compensating the weak signal. Okay, so our aim is to have a constant SQNR for all type of signals. Whether it is a weak signal or strong signal, doesn't matter. The SQNR is a uniform. Why? Because it represents the quality of the output. Okay, the quality should not depend upon whether your voice is weak or strong. We should have a constant SQNR. Okay, why it is so important? Because suppose if you speak very slowly, you get very bad result. If you have to speak loudly, then only you get very good result. It should be avoided. If you speak slow or loud, doesn't matter. We should get a minimum quality of the output. Okay. So in other words, I have to make my SQNR independent of the type of signal. Whether it is a weak signal or strong signal, doesn't matter. My SQNR should be independent of all these things. Okay. Now for that purpose, we go for non-uniform quantization, where the step size varies. Okay, right, next. Yes, now how it is possible, how to implement the non-uniform quantizer? To implement non-uniform quantizer, we use something called compressor. What is a compressor? This is a compressor, input, output. So compressor is, what is happening, you observe very carefully here. So you take these two things. Okay, so let me draw very clearly here. Okay, it provides more gain for weak signals. You observe very carefully, it provides more gain for weak signal. it provides less gain for strong signals. You observe these things very carefully. Okay, you observe this diagram. So what happened here? Weak signal, it is having more gain. So this is a strong signal. So here this is a gap. What is the gap here? Reduced. Okay, so it provides more gain to the weak signal, less gain to the strong signal. It is called compressor. Obviously, we need a reverse of compressor, that is called expander. This is expander, exactly opposite of the compressor. Okay, so in this non-uniform quantizers, we use compressor and expanders. What is a compressor? Which provides more gain to weak signal and less gain to strong signal. So, yeah. So here we are using compressor, expander, and we have a uniform quantizer. Please make a note of this. Actually, here we are studying about non-uniform quantizers. Be careful. Okay, I'll explain a little bit later, but let me complete this compressor and expander. Yeah. So this is the compressor. Okay, and this is the expander, expansion. How are they? They're exactly opposite of each other. What's the net effect? This line. What is the net effect? There is no net effect. Okay, we are compressing and we are expanding later. Obviously, there is no change. The overall change is zero. Correct? Okay, that is about compression and expansion. Okay, now here, so we have something called compander. Compander. Very, very important. Compander. What is a compander? It is a combination of compressor and expander. So the combination of compressor and expander is called compander. Okay. So in the compression, we take COMP. We take COMP from the compressor. Expanding, we take this AND. So combined, we call companding. So compressor and expander. This is from the term expander. It is from the term compander. Compressor. Combinedly called as compander. Okay. So written very carefully in the PPTs, you can go through it. Compression, expanding. So we are taking these two terms and called as a compander. It is simply combination of compression and expansion. Okay. So okay, right. Now, so what is a non-uniform quantizer? So the combination of compressor and uniform quantizer is called as, this is called as non-uniform quantizer. Be careful, don't get confused. The combination of compressor and expanding is called compander, but the combination of, okay, let me write here clearly, compressor and uniform quantizer is called non-uniform quantizer. Okay, here, so these two combinedly called as non-uniform quantizer, whereas compressor and expander is combinedly called as compander. Okay, don't get confused here. So this is the non-uniform quantizer. So the purpose of non-uniform quantizer is to, what the purpose, can you tell me? We have to make SQNR independent of input signal. Okay, I will explain a little bit later. Yes. Okay. Now, so here. Now, so in the compounder, we have a compressor, no? Okay. We have a standardized compressors known as Mula and Ela compressors. These are widely used compressors around the globe. Mula and Ela. So this is the Mula compressor. This is the Ela compressor. Here I am showing only the positive portion. Actually, how is the compressor? It is like this actually. This is the part, this is only positive portion. So actually the compressor is like this. This is a compressor. Like this. So here in this graph I am showing only this positive portion. Mean this portion. Yeah, so this is the compression for various values of mu. Now this is the Ela compressor. This is the compression for various values of A. So these are two widely used compressors around the globe. Obviously, so for these compressors, there is a reverse of that, that is called expanders. So I am not doing all those things here. But remember, the optimum values of A equal to 87.6 and mu equal to 255. So for Mula compressor, the optimum value of mu is 255, and for Ela compressor, the optimum value of A is 87.6. So these are the widely used compressors. So in India we use Ela compressor. Different countries use different compressors. So there is a international standardization of the compressors. Some countries use Mula compressor, some other countries use Ela compressors. Okay, so you remember these values. Now, so this is the difference between uniform and non-uniform compressors or quantizers. Sorry, for uniform quantizers, I have drawn already relative input signal power in dBs. I have drawn already this linear curve. Okay, now for non-uniform, you get like this. Here I am using Mula compressor with a value of 255. Here mu equal to 0. If mu equal to 0, there is no compression. There is no compression. It is simply uniform quantizer. If you use Mula compressor with a value of, with optimum value of 255, it is non-uniform quantizer. It is uniform quantizer. It is a non-uniform quantizer. This is SQNR in dBs. Okay, here what is happening? So you observe very clearly. Okay, so the SQNR is almost same for all type of input signals. Do you agree or not? How the SQNR? It is something like this. You observe here, no? It is something like this. This is almost constant conducting. So whether you have a low or weak signal or strong signal, we are getting the same quality, almost same quality, relatively same quality. Why? Because the SQNR is becoming flat. It is independent of the input signal power. Whether you give a weak signal or strong signal, it doesn't matter. Okay, but in uniform quantizers, if you give 20 dB power, you get 10 dB SQNR. If you give 50 dB power, you get 40 dB SQNR. Obviously, weak signals, low SQNR, strong signal, high SQNR. But with help of uniform quantizer, non-uniform quantizers, whether your input signal is weak or strong doesn't matter. Always you get around, let us take 35 dB. Whether it is strong or weak doesn't matter, you get a constant 35 dB SQNR at the output of the non-uniform quantizer. So the quantizer gives relatively better quality for all type of input speech signals. Okay, right. So this is about non-uniform quantizers. Okay, we stop here. Thank you.